there are over 30 mutations to the Omicron variant. Is that a cause for concern for, or is it normal for viruses to have these many mutations?
Well, viruses do mutate. The number of mutations that they can develop depends partly on the time they get to mutate in a human body. So if you are being harbored in a person who is immunocompromised or very elderly and therefore immunodeficient, then the virus has a great deal of opportunity in terms of time to have several mutations because it keeps replicating in large numbers. And with multiple replications, it can also have mutations. Now, in this particular case, it has developed 32 mutations of the spike protein additionally, which means that it had ample time. But given that South Africa, Botswana, and other Southern African countries have a fair amount of HIV/AIDS, Botswana in particular has a lot of HIV/AIDS even now. And if one of the persons who is immunocompromised gets this infection, there's ample opportunity for the virus to mutate substantially.
And so the vaccine efficacy studies prove wanes over time, right? And most of our 45 plus population has now been vaccinated for over 6 months now. Is that really a concern for, with the new virus or with the new variant cropping up?
Well, we do not know whether the new virus has entered or can enter India. At the moment, we are still dealing with the most prevalent virus variant, which is the Delta variant. Delta variant is still around. It is still causing a few cases, not too many, partly because many people were exposed to the Delta variant during the horrendous second wave and have acquired some degree of immunity, which may be still lasting. Secondly, we also know that the vaccination rate has increased in recent months, and that also would provide some protection. Even if many of the people have received only one dose, there would be some degree of protection. Laboratory studies are still being conducted to see how effective the pre-existing antibodies or T-cell immunity is against this variant. We know, for example, that against Delta, some of the vaccines which were developed originally against the wild virus or the Wuhan virus, as well as against the Alpha variant, they had diminished efficacy compared to the original clinical trials. So it is possible that this particular variant also would have the similar effect of further reduced efficacy. But even if it is reduced, it doesn't mean absent immunity. It is likely that you may still have more than 50% efficacy. It's also possible that some of the impact that has already had, the virus and the vaccines have had on memory T cells and memory B cells may also come into play, and our immunity may get again further enhanced by that trigger. So we still have to wait and see, but the best prevention, of course, is to try and prevent a person from getting infected in the first place.
And so what is your take on booster shots? Most of the world has now authorized booster shots, most of the developed world at least. Should India take a call for it on for the vulnerable population 60 plus, at least those who've been vaccinated 6 months ago or 7 months ago? Because if it's not this variant, there may be another variant.
Yes, the policy is dependent upon how we define variability or vulnerability and how do we actually set our priorities. Secondly, it also depends upon the supply of the vaccines that are available and the availability of vaccination teams to administer the vaccine in large numbers. While other functions of the health system also have to be conducted, it's not as though COVID vaccination is the only thing that our health system should undertake. So I think there's a fine balance here. I think the government decided that booster doses can be deferred, not completely denied, but deferred till we are sure that we have vaccinated as many people as possible with the second dose, apart from saturating everybody with the first dose at least, ensuring that everybody gets the first dose among the adult eligible population. And the second dose to the most vulnerable people certainly must be prioritized. Then, of course, the question of whether we vaccinate people with booster doses will come in. And there, people who are likely to have low levels of immune response, either to the natural infection or to the vaccine, because of age, advanced age, other debilitating health conditions, or immunosuppression because of drugs or disease, they are the people who need to be prioritized for any such booster dose. Whether we can actually give everybody in the adult population a booster dose and also simultaneously start child vaccination is dependent partly on the availability of vaccines as well. If we have plenty of vaccines for our domestic consumption and also enough number of vaccinating teams who can deliver these vaccines, perhaps at that time, we may get into a more liberal policy of booster doses. But to answer your question as to whether we do now need to set the priorities, yes, I believe people who are vaccinated very early, from, for example, from January to April this year, who were health workers or who are health workers, who are elderly and who are immunocompromised, they are the people who should be identified for booster dose, and we should start getting ready for administering booster doses to them on a priority. And even younger people, including children with immunocompromised state, should get the vaccination anyway. But in terms of booster doses, these are the people who need to be prioritized.
And sir, is there a need to expedite the process of vaccinating children? Because now that schools are reopening and we have this social distancing may go for a toss for sure. So is there a need for that as well?
Well, I think it's a question of trying to identify how to prioritize with the supplies that we have and with the vaccination teams that we have. First priority still goes to vaccinating the vulnerable people who are the elderly and those with comorbidities or associated health conditions, which are likely to give low immune response to infection or to vaccination in the first place. So those with diminished immunity must be given that booster. Then, of course, the question of whether we complete two vaccine doses for all adults as intended, that is a priority. Among the children, we should still prioritize people who are more likely to be getting severe disease based on any associated disease conditions or depressed immunity. But in general, children have been found world over to have less risk of severe disease. And therefore, the priority according to universal child immunization is lower down the scale. And to believe that children need to be protected from the infection and that children also should not become transmission agents, we actually should encourage the use of masks apart from vaccination in all adults so that they do not expose children to the virus, whichever setting, whether home or school. At the same time, older children also should be asked to wear masks when they're indoor. Naturally, in outdoor settings, when they play in outdoor, well-ventilated areas, they may not be masked. But I think on gauging the amount of risk at the moment, children do not immediately qualify as a priority group till the other priority groups are exhausted.
So while we talk about deaths, one of the things that get mentioned, gets forgotten is the daily adjusted life years and how COVID has impacted that. So sir, is there some takeoff on that, that what has been the impact on daily adjusted life years? Because UK did do a study which said that 1/3 of the population had long COVID. So should from that perspective as well?
Well, I think it's still an evolving area of study, because long COVID also, how many of the people will recover in what period of time is not yet certain. And long COVID also has a wide spectrum of disorders. There are people with significant lung disease. There are people who have developed diabetes. There are people who have developed some heart damage. There have been people who have developed some brain effects as well. Not just brain fog, but also organ damage. Mm-hmm. So, but they appear to be in a relative minority. The majority of the people seem to recover over a period of a few months. Emotional and psychiatric and mental health problems may remain or may linger on, but overall their functional ability in terms of physical disease seems to be not that much limited after a few months. So how much of COVID has had an effect, we need to see. But I think the other impact that we need to measure is what is the impact of unattended or poorly attended other disease conditions. When we are talking of disability-adjusted life years lost to COVID, it's not just the direct effect of COVID. How much of diabetes treatment was neglected? How much of heart disease treatment was neglected? How much of cancer treatment was neglected? How much of pregnancy-related problems occurred because of poor antenatal care? All of that will actually go into the table when we start counting what the overall health impact of COVID is.
So one last question, besides the social distancing and the requirement for masks and everything else that is COVID-appropriate behavior, is there a need to reinvest more in antivirals now? Because vaccines, you'll need to give booster doses as virus evolves and everything, but antivirals can actually help stave off a lot of these problems.
Yes, we do need, definitely, but we need proven drugs. And therefore, that's where the trials need to go on. Therefore, prevention is absolutely critical. Boosting innate immunity with proper diet and proper exercise and preferably exposure to clean air, all those are important as well, so that you can withstand not only the COVID virus, but influenza viruses and other respiratory viruses. So building innate immunity is absolutely important. Then ensuring that you get vaccinated is important. Getting tested with early onset of symptoms is important, but at least getting our syndromic surveillance based on symptoms through household visits by primary healthcare teams is important. But getting also the treatment facilities in place, particularly if we can only, we can talk about relatively inexpensive. And I lay the emphasis on inexpensive because drugs will have to become affordable. Antivirals, which can be given at home as part of home care management rather than letting people go to the hospital, will definitely have an impact. So apart from vaccines, drugs that are used in intensive care, oxygen therapy, certainly oral antiviral therapy would also be a very important element. But all of that needs to be evidence-based, based on well-founded clinical trials.
If you like this video, share it and subscribe to Business Standard. For more news, views and insights, log on to www.business-standard.com. Do also follow us on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Telegram and LinkedIn.